Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the featured speaker for Big Data, Powerful Predictions Through Data Analytics, statistician, founder of 538.com, and author of The Signal and the Noise, Nate Silver.
Hey, can you all hear me? It's pretty weird to be like at a baseball stadium and not seeing a baseball game, I have to admit. I'm going to Cleveland tomorrow for the GOP convention, so another arena where there's going to be all types of theatrics, but no Cavaliers game. But anyway, thank you all for joining me today. And I'm here to give a talk about big data, and really what I want to talk about is how this stuff gets applied in practice. There's a lot of hype, I'll talk about that in a moment, over analytics and big data, all these related technologies. But what's that really mean? You sometimes get the impression that, oh, big data is this amazing technology, and all of a sudden you get big data, you wave a wand, and all your problems are solved. You see this kind of slide here is from an article in Wired magazine from 2008. It says, the end of theory of the data deluge makes the scientific method obsolete. The idea here being that all you need is so much information, and then you can find correlations, you can find meaning. You solve every problem by brute force, right? By having computers that can crunch through billions or trillions of observations. In fact, this idea is wrong, or at least incomplete. It's not just about raw computing power. We need human capital, too, and talent to understand what you really do with this kind of all this information we have at our disposal. By the way, think about when this article was written in the summer of 2008. This was a time in which the entire global financial system was melting down. That was a big data-driven field. You see lots of types of things here. These are all events that represented failures of prediction of one kind or another. The earthquake that hit Japan, for example, in 2011. There were some seismologists there who said you couldn't possibly have an earthquake that large. That's why you had the Fukushima reactor was built only to tolerate an 8.4 earthquake or 8.5, and you had a 9.1. You know, hurricanes and so forth. Politics, too, we've had a lot of unpredictable political events in recent years, and so it's not so easy. We're not necessarily getting better at prediction as a society just because we have more data and information at our disposal. To put this in a little bit more context, this is a slide that the Gartner Group, a technology consulting firm, uses that shows what's the adaptation of new technology look like. And you start out, and there's some triggering event, a new technology becomes available or cheap enough, you know, computer power to be widespread. There's a big burst of hype about it, and then people realize, you know what, it's not as easy as I thought. It doesn't solve all my problems. Think about, for example, the dot-com boom and bust in the 90s. Well, it turned out that internet commerce was really important, but expectations got a little bit ahead of themselves. Computing power itself, if you go to the early 1980s and read the New York Times about, oh, they'll say personal computers, oh, this, you know, these don't really accomplish anything. People are too expensive for regular users, businesses don't need them. Well, it turned out they would have a big effect 10 or 20 years later. So I'm worried that with big data right now, we're at the peak of the hype cycle right now, and that people don't realize that we need a lot of expertise for how to actually use it. And by the way, since I'm a guy who is data-driven himself, this is a slide showing the number of corporate press releases that mention the two-word phrase big data. So you see, as of a year ago or so, you kind of begin to reach a peak where we're maximally hyped right now, but not necessarily maximally skilled. So the rest of the talk is about just some insights I want to share about both that I've experienced myself, done some things wrong, but also talking to people in for my book that I wrote a couple of years ago, Signal the Noise, about what are some challenges for using big data in practice. You know, maybe the biggest one of all is that we are not as used to being bombarded with so much information as we get today. It seems like every time you turn on your Twitter feed or turn on the news, there's some cataclysmic event in the world, some astounding, shocking event. We're bombarded with information now, and it's kind of hard to put things all into perspective. We are in the midst of a political campaign. I deal with this a lot when it comes to polling. This is data from 4 years ago showing polling in the state of Virginia, of course, an important swing state between Obama and Romney. Just a scatter plot showing every poll in Virginia over the course of the final 150 days of the campaign. So from about where we are now until November. And you see how kind of random it looks. You have everything from polls showing Obama up by 9 to Romney up by 6. There's not all that obvious a pattern. In fact, if you're applying the right kind of algorithms to this to say what actually has been the pattern, it's really pretty steady. On average, Obama is up by 2 or 3 points in Virginia at the very end of the race. He gets a little bit of an uptick, so he winds up being up by 4 or 5 points instead. That's the margin that he would eventually win by. So this is the kind of right way to look at it, is to actually be quite patient, quite long-term, and thinking about the information that you're getting, not overreacting to new bits of information. The truth is, though, that most people, and certainly people if you're watching, reading the news every day or your Twitter feed, most people react like this instead. They're too aggressive about connecting the dots. In a technical sense, this term is called overfitting, where you have an overly rigid mask to explain the past that actually doesn't tell you very much at all about either what the real shape is, what the real pattern is, or what's going to happen next. But this is a problem that becomes worse when you have more data. If you only have a few data points, then it becomes hard to screw up. The data might be wrong, but your analysis isn't going to be able to make things worse than it really might be. By the way, with political data in particular, part of the problem is that people are not just have an overflow of information, but also they get that information and interpret it rather selectively. Only about 5% of people watching Fox News are Democrats. Only about 1% of MSNBC's viewers are Republicans on a typical afternoon. So you really see this in particular with, I think, Trump versus Clinton. It's been a cliche for a long time that people are kind of inhabiting different universes in this big diverse country of ours, but in this race in particular, you don't really have a meeting of the minds, and this is dangerous too. There's no possible way, even me though it's my job, I can't possibly read every bit of news about the campaign that I would like to every day. Most people don't have that kind of time either, but people are getting a filtered information that's curated for them and actually can make them more narrow-minded in some ways. Doesn't mean that both sides are each right half the time, I don't believe that, but it does mean that you know, this whole idea of curating your social media feeds, whatever else, filter bubble, all this stuff is new and will affect us in somewhat unpredictable ways. So another issue you get has to do with the complexity of relationships that we're studying, what I call the signal-to-noise ratio. So usually data isn't really that interesting for data's sake. We don't care that much about what this Giants second baseman is batting. We care about whether that makes him a good player or not and helps the Giants win. So you're looking for relationships here. The thing is, though, that as you expand the number of variables you have available, the relationships become much more complex very quickly. Where you see here in a universe with 5 variables, then you have 10 two-way relationships in the data. As you expand now, you have, and we have 10 variables, we have 45 relationships. If you guys are in meetings, and I'm sure that you are, you know that when you go from having 5 people in a meeting to 10 people in a meeting, there are a lot more dynamics that can occur. Sometimes it's helpful, sometimes not very helpful. But the interactions become much more complex much more quickly. And then in some areas, economic data, for example, the Federal Reserve now publishes 384,000 data points or statistics that they update more or less in real time. Which means there are 73,727,808,000 combinations. So what's the problem with this? It seems like this must be a good thing to have more information, right? Well, one problem you encounter is that you encounter a lot of false positives. So there's a saying that if you're 1 in a million in New York, there are 7 other people just like you. In big data, when you have a data set this large, you can find a 1 in a million coincidence, and there are going to be thousands of these in a data set where you have so much complexity and so many options for how to look at the data. If you guys are geeks like me, you've heard of examples from the replication crisis in science, which means that a lot of findings that are found to be statistically significant turn out not to be duplicable, which means that someone else, when they try and replicate the same experiment in the same way, does not get even remotely the same result. That's a big problem. It's a problem in some ways of having more data at your disposal. You know, to give you one fun example of a false positive, it's weird to have a football slide at a baseball stadium, but for many years there have been a correlation between which team won the Super Bowl, which conference won the Super Bowl, and how well the stock market did over the course of the next year. So when you had an NFC team like the New York Giants win the Super Bowl, it was a good year for the stock market. When the AFC team won, the Patriots, for example, you had a bad year. Then in February 2008, you had a famous Super Bowl. The Patriots had been undefeated that year, 16-0. They were upset by the Giants, so that should have been a really good omen for the stock market if the historical pattern was true. If you guys remember, though, what happened in 2008, you actually had the worst year for the stock market since the Great Depression. If you're betting on a correlation and you don't understand the causality behind it, I would want to be on the other side of that bet. People don't realize how creative we are at finding these correlations, whether we have between our pattern matching abilities as human beings and computer power. We're very, very good at finding correlations and telling ourselves stories about them, but finding causality and replicable correlations is a much more challenging area. I'm going to try and get at this theme one more time in a slightly more kind of mathematically inclined way, but it's the same thing, but that gets this notion of false signals or false positives. So let's say you're in a heavy information environment or a big data type of environment. You have lots and lots and oodles of data, but relatively little of it is all that useful necessarily. So you're trying to find a signal in the noise, sort of literally. And this conception, the red circles are useful information. Maybe if you're looking, for example, for a rare disease, or maybe you're looking for evidence of terrorist activity, for example, that's what you want to find. And the black are false positives instead. They're things that look like the real thing, but just lead you off the trail. So you start out in an environment where there aren't that many true signals, but you're smart, you have good software, you have good technology, you apply a filter, and only 80%, you block out 80% of the false positives. And likewise, you capture 80% of the real signals. So you've made a lot of improvements here, but still, because you're in a signal poor environment to begin with, most of your findings are false here. This might seem like an arbitrary example. It actually comes, though, from healthcare. It comes from mammography, where if you give a woman in her 40s, breast cancer incidence is low for women in their 40s, very low. If you give a woman in her 40s a mammogram, and she has a positive mammogram, she probably does not have breast cancer because the underlying rate is very low. In fact, you have to have two or three mammograms return positive before you actually are more likely than not, as a woman in your 40s, to have breast cancer. You know, people, I think, don't realize how information poor, how signal poor, rather, some environments can be because you have so much information. You know, and there are ways to work around this and ways to be more careful, clinical trials, for example. But it does mean that we need a new set of skills that we didn't have previously. Another issue, which is kind of familiar to people who are doing coding or whatever else, I call it feature or bug. So I live right now in New York. I live on 30th Street and 7th Avenue. It's kind of, they call it Northeast Chelsea in the real estate brochures. It's kind of no man's land, really. But I was giving a talk at the Guggenheim Museum a year or so ago, which is on 89th and 5th, I think. And, you know, New York is, traffic's terrible, obviously. But from a navigational standpoint, we don't have all the confusing diagonal streets and crap that you guys have here, right? It's all rectilinear, they're all numbered sequentially, so getting from point A to point B, in theory, should be pretty easy. This is the route that Google Maps recommend I take to get to the Guggenheim, for example. By contrast, this is the route that my taxi driver took that day instead. So we make three crossings through Central Park, do a little loop-de-loop at 72nd Street or something, and finally get to the Guggenheim about 40 minutes late. So I was trying to figure out what this guy was doing, and in fact, he was following turn by turn the instructions that his GPS device gave him. That's what the GPS recommended that he do. And I figured out the reason why is because there is a road that cuts north to south through Central Park called, I think, East Drive. East Drive, it's kind of a picturesque road. It's where, like, a lot of people get murdered on Law and Order and stuff like that. But the GPS correctly detected that there was no traffic on East Drive that day. And so it's saying, look, I'm going to do everything I can to get to East Drive. Once I'm at East Drive, it's a shortcut. I'm basically there instantly. It's not very far geographically to get through Central Park. What it didn't realize, and the driver didn't realize, is that East Drive was closed that time of day. It's only open at rush hours. This is a 2 p.m. talk. You can't go to East Drive then, and because of this one, you know, this one basically buggy, not buggy line of code even, but failing to understand whether the road was open or closed that day, what it thought was doing me a great service, in fact, made me go 40 minutes out of my way instead. So I like to think sometimes about, we talk about sometimes the conflict between, oh, you have a data-driven algorithmic approach, and you have your gut feeling, or your experience, or your intuition. I think people sometimes get the order reversed, where I know certainly in the fields I cover for a living, like sports and politics, people kind of think with their gut a lot, and they'll put the sheen of data around a problem and say, oh, see, this kind of proves what my gut instinct was, where really it should be the other way around. I think you want to start out doing the first 80% of the work with your algorithm, with your data, trying to be as objective as possible. It's a loaded term, of course, being very careful and explicit about which assumptions that you make. And then at the end is when you apply your accumulated knowledge, your gut instinct. This driver, for example, should have known that you basically should never cross Central Park twice on the same journey unless you see Godzilla on the Chrysler Building and you have to double back or something like that. And so instead of leading with your gut, having a gut check at the end can be a valuable tool. But again, you know, a lot of the fields that I cover are competitive. Certainly sports is one of them. And it's kind of one thing if you're in the abstract trying to find a signal in the noise. Another thing when you have 30 major league teams that are competing against you to do the same thing. Or in the stock market where you think a commodity is undervalued or overvalued, well, the price that the stock is priced at reflects the wisdom of everyone else too. So these dynamics to me are really quite interesting, and it means that sometimes your kind of first answer might not be the best one, and that if you have an answer that's way different than what everyone else says, then you have to be doubly sure that this is a feature of your code, of your model, and not bad data, not a bug instead. So I'm going to move from kind of the more depressing, it's complicated part, talking about suggestions. I won't call them solutions, but a few things attitudinally that I think are useful ways to look at problems where big data and analytics are pertinent. So you see here, it's the only algebraic equation in the presentation today, so don't worry, but this is a mathematical depiction of Bayes' theorem. Bayes' theorem is a very old scientific formula, represented or created by Thomas Bayes, a reverend in England, a few hundred years ago. And all Bayes' theorem is about, it's about conditional probability. But another way it means, it's how you update your view of the world as more information comes into play. So for example, maybe you're here today, meeting some people that you didn't know all that well, and then you learn more about them. Maybe your first impressions are wrong. In some ways, that's a Bayesian process where you start out by making stereotypes about someone. You say, well, I know which company you work for and what you look like and what your age is and how you talk and how you're dressed and everything else, right? Sometimes the stereotypes turn to be totally wrong. Sometimes they're right too. Likewise, when you're dealing with a complex problem, you start out with a view of how likely is Hillary Clinton or Donald Trump to become president. And you update that and scrutinize that and test that as you collect more data. Sometimes you think you know what you're doing, and then you realize, you know what, that evidence is not consistent with what I'm seeing in the new information that I'm collecting. That's all a very Bayesian process. And there are three kind of habits that come out of this that I think are super important. Number one, think probabilistically. Number two, know where you're coming from. Number three, try and error. you know, again, these things sound good as bumper stickers, but I'll talk a little bit about why they require a lot of discipline and focus and practice. So if you read my book, you know I'm a big fan of weather forecasters. They're some of the most fascinating people you'll meet, data scientists, if you will, and they kind of combine very advanced technology with very good judgment and everything else. A lot of them are ex-military and ex-Air Force. But there have been a few snafus, too, in weather forecasting over time. So I'm going to give you a negative example first. So in 1997, you had a major flood in North Dakota. And the reason I'm interested in this is because it was a case where there was a poor effort at communicating uncertainty that made the problem a lot worse. So what happens in North Dakota is that you, of course, have a lot of snow every winter, and finally, by March or so, that snow begins to melt. If you have a very fast thaw and you have a lot of snow and it melts too quickly, then you have the risk of flooding in the streams and rivers up there. And so 97, very heavy snowfall, risk of flooding. The Weather Service issued a forecast in Grand Forks, North Dakota, saying, on the worst day, we think the waters will crest at 49 feet. People, though, are smart up there. They're like, well, we have levees, flood walls that go up to 51 feet instead. You can do math. 51 is better than 49. Therefore, we'll be okay. What the Weather Service didn't communicate, though, is what the margin of error was in their forecast, which was plus or minus 9 feet. In fact, the levee or waters would crest at 53 feet on the worst day of the flood. And so, well within the margin of error, but it toppled the flood walls and 3/4 of the buildings in town were damaged or destroyed. Fortunately, this was not a Katrina-type situation. This disaster evolved more slowly than that, so people were able to get away without any loss of life. But you did have enormous amounts of property damage when you could have potentially built some sandbags if you had more time, or at the very least, insured the property. By the time this flooding occurred, everyone knew it was going to be a disaster, and you had lots and lots of uninsured losses. You needed a big federal and state bailout as a result. But at the time, so this was 1997, almost 20 years ago now, the Weather Service had been concerned that if they conveyed uncertainty in their forecast, that people wouldn't trust the forecast. You know, that's actually the opposite of what you should do. In general, the person who is willing to communicate, here's the risks, here are the opportunities, and here's my percentage estimate or my model's estimate of how likely something is, you know, that's usually a lot more trustworthy. A lot of times the gains we make when using big data are around the margin instead, and I don't know, I used to play, the World Series of Poker is going right now in Vegas. I'll talk about poker in a moment, but you know, in poker you're all looking for small edges, for understanding how probabilities work, and not for some magic bullet solution. This is something where, certainly in the political realm, people think in a very deterministic way. They think, well, something ought to be this way. They think in terms of black and white, no shades of gray, really. So, you know, we're always evolving how we communicate. When we launched our general election forecast a couple of weeks ago, we had Clinton with about an 80% chance of winning, but we said our headline was Trump has a 20% chance of winning. People understand that differently. They understand, oh, that means that could really happen. And if you say Clinton has an 80% chance of winning, by the way, Trump's chances are up to more like 35% now. The polls have tightened a little bit. And so learning to lead with the bottom, with the trailing candidates number, actually kind of makes people think about things a little bit more correctly. By the way, I said that weather forecasters are very impressive, so I want to talk about one of their success stories, too. This is the forecast they issued 4.5 days in advance of Hurricane Sandy hitting New York in 2012. So you see a couple things here. Number one, you see that they're visualizing the uncertainties. You go out in time, the uncertainty increases. You know, people's visual intuitions are often a lot better than if you're just trying to put something in an equation or in words. And so the more you're visualizing things and being in depth with graphics is a really, really useful thing to do. But also their forecast turned out to be really, really good. You had a very complex, unprecedented type of storm, and yet 4.5 days in advance, they were able to predict almost the exact county in New Jersey where that storm would make landfall. As a result, you had a substantial saving of life. You can't predict property very well in a hurricane, but people, by and large, did not die in large numbers in Sandy like they had in some earlier storms. And weather forecasters have now a very good track record of forecasting hurricanes, where 25 years ago, 30 years ago, if you had a hurricane in the Gulf of Mexico, the forecast would miss by about 350 miles on average. It's not even a margin of error, that's the average miss. So basically, totally useless forecast where it says, well, it could be anywhere from Florida to Texas. Well, thanks a lot. Now the forecasts get within about 100 miles on average instead. That's actionable intelligence. You can evacuate the Jersey Shore or the Gulf Coast. That winds up saving a lot of lives and a very major improvement. So what is it that weather forecasters do that differentiate them from, if you read my book, you know there are lots of fields where you haven't seen much progress in forecasting? Number one, they do have great technology. Where weather forecasting uses supercomputers. What they're trying to literally do is simulate the environment. If you guys live here in the Bay Area, you know how crazy it is from one side of the bay to the other. It used to be that 30 years ago, the whole Bay Area would just be one grid, one little pixel in that grid. You couldn't have a very precise forecast. Now they can get it down to much narrower grids, and therefore you have a much finer, more precise forecast. It also requires more computing power to crunch all those numbers. Number two is that they have good theory, too. So it's a merger of theory and data. By theory, I mean we basically understand pretty well how the atmosphere works. We understand why it rains, why it snows, why there's wind. So it's not blindly applied analytics. It's directed analytics used to solve equations that we understand pretty well. So the combination of things is helpful here. The third and maybe the most important thing of all is that weather forecasters have a lot of practice, where every day there are, I think, 400 and some weather offices around the United States. They issue forecasts for every hour of every day for 10 different types of conditions, so temperature, rainfall, barometric pressure, fog, everything else. When you issue that many forecasts, then you get wrong answers beaten out of you pretty quickly. You learn from your mistakes really fast. That's a very helpful thing, too. So, you know, in general, the fields where you see a lot of progress made in forecasting are areas like sports, like weather, you know, a lot of consumer-facing stuff where you interact with a problem every day. Problems like politics and economics, where you only have an event every 4 or 5 years, very difficult. You might be right, you might be wrong, you might be lucky, you might be unlucky, and you're going to have to wait another 4 years before you get another chance to know that one way or the other. Idea number two, know where you're coming from. In other words, try and be aware, as hard as it might be, of what your own biases might be and what your perspective might be. If you kind of put it that way, sounds a little bit better sometimes. But this example here is adopted. If you guys have read Sheryl Sandberg, COO of Facebook, her book, Lean In, she talks about hiring. It's pertinent in the tech sector, pertinent also, I think her examples come from hiring for police departments and so forth, where there are fields in this country where if male and female applicants with identical credentials apply for the job, the man is more likely to get a callback. And so Sheryl Sandberg cites some of these studies and tries to go into why a little bit. What she found, though, is that it's actually the hiring managers who say they have no gender bias who are more likely to be biased, more likely not to call back an equally qualified female candidate in this case. So the simple lesson here is that if you're aware that, yeah, gender shapes my view in male-dominated fields, I have to kind of consciously think about that when I'm making hiring decisions, that winds up working a lot better. I mean, I think, frankly, also in politics, if people are aware that, you know, hey, look, I might have things I'm rooting for. I have political views myself. You know, I want my forecast to be right. I don't want to have to change my mind. It looks stupid when you change your mind. But the fact is that you have to, it works really hard work to try and be objective. But being aware that, you know, that you do have your own interest and you have to try and separate that is a lot better than saying, oh, I'm using data, therefore I'm being objective. Using data is great. But there are ways to use data in very non-objective ways. Look at how, you know, any senator or governor talks about putting facts in context that are meant to make them look good instead of actually getting at the truth. And so being aware that that we all have biases, I believe strongly there is such a thing as objectivity, but we are all ourselves are subjective. By the way, working in groups or working in teams where you have diverse teams, diverse in all types of ways, both in terms of maybe people's backgrounds, but also people's skills and their manners of looking at things and having a culture, a work culture, where people are able to disagree. If you have 30 people in a room and they all think identically, it's not really any better than having one person give the same answer 30 times. So thinking about how these group dynamics work is important too. The last slide here, and I talked about this a little bit before, but trial and error is a really useful thing. You can spend lots and lots of time looking at a model in the abstract, but when you're actually making forecasts, making predictions, testing ideas on customers, you learn a lot more quickly. But I'll make this a little bit more fun by talking about my my brief career as a professional poker player. So in 2003, there was a poker boom, or I call it a poker bubble, in the United States. Partly because of this guy you see here named Chris Moneymaker, good name for a poker player. Chris Moneymaker was an accountant. He worked for Deloitte & Touche. At the time, I worked for a big four accounting firm myself, KPMG, doing something called transfer pricing consulting. But he decided to deposit $20 in an online tournament one day, won that online tournament, so turned a $20 entry fee into a $10,000 entry into the real bricks and mortar World Series of Poker in Las Vegas, and then won that tournament too. So he turned $20 into $2 million. It's not quite rags to riches, it's like upper middle class consultant into temporary millionaire, but still, for poker standards, it made for pretty good TV. And the network I work for now, I should disclose, ESPN, broadcast poker continuously. This year there was a hockey strike, lots and lots of poker on TV in 2003-2004. When you see poker on TV, though, the innovation that ESPN had is that it's a lot more fun when you're watching poker on TV if you know what cards the players have. Otherwise, it's kind of boring to see two guys sitting there and you can't figure out what's going on. So they have the whole cam, it's called. You see in this hand here that Chris Moneymaker is bluffing. He missed his draw. Sam Farha actually has top pair, and Sam Farha eventually folds top pair. So if you're watching on TV, you're like, this poker thing is pretty easy. You know, I would have seen Chris Moneymaker's tell. I wouldn't have folded like Sam Farha did, right? I'm going to be the next Chris Moneymaker. Poker is easy if you can see the person's hand. That's the whole name of the game, but it's a lot harder in real life. But anyway, there was a poker boom. I made a fair bit of money playing poker for a while, but I also, in the name of science, collected data on what the poker economy looked like. So this is data mined from a poker site that reflects how much money each player is making and losing over the long run. So there's a lot of luck, obviously, in poker, but this is supposed to represent, if you bring the luck out of it and you play an infinite number of hands, how much do you make or lose? It turns out the worst player at the table is losing about $420 per hour. So not very good. In fact, if this guy folded every hand instead, he would only lose $200 an hour playing the blinds. So he's actually making his problems twice as bad by trying. Conversely, the best player at the table is making about $100 an hour instead, so that's a pretty healthy rate of return, but you see it's asymmetric here, both because in poker, the house takes a cut, so the average player loses a little bit of money, but also because of this kind of learning curve you have here. It's an 80-20 curve. It's kind of the most generic PowerPoint slide in history, but it's applicable actually to our learning process when we deal with big data types of environments. So usually when we are faced with a complex, mathematically complex problem, getting a few basic things right gets you a surprisingly far amount of the way there. So in poker, if you know nothing else about poker, except you have some idea for what a good and a bad hand is, and so I say, look, I want you to, every time you have a good hand, then raise. If you have an okay hand, then call. And if you have a bad hand, then fold. You know, that's the right play about 80% of the time. There's no bluffing in that strategy, there's no deception, so you become a little bit predictable, but still, that will go from losing $400 an hour to losing $40 an hour instead. You've kind of gotten 80% of the way there. Baseball, too. I can't talk about a little bit about, or I can't not talk a little bit about baseball here, but you guys may have read the book or seen the movie Moneyball, and the story of Moneyball about the other team here in the Bay Area, Billy Beane, the Oakland A's, who realized that on-base percentage was an undervalued commodity in baseball. These guys were not getting paid, even though on-base percentage correlates very well with scoring runs. That's the name of the game. So Billy Beane's A's began to emphasize on-base percentage, began to sign a bunch of cheap free agents who are very good at getting on base, and you see what happens. He takes over as GM in 98, and you see a big spike in their on-base percentage. They reach the playoffs a couple of times by having a very small payroll, and that's kind of when Moneyball is written, and they don't tell you what happened afterward. What happened afterward is that the rest of the league caught up with Billy Beane. That on base percentage was such a simple and obvious thing that once teams realize, like, hey, there's basically free money lying on the ground here, every other team is going after these guys too. It becomes very expensive to acquire. By the way, you begin to realize that pitching is the other side of this, so preventing guys from getting on base, you don't want pitchers that allow a lot of walks. Strikeouts are a good thing instead. So that revolutionizes the whole game, but in a way that Billy Beane loses his edge pretty fast. So that's why this last 20% or less 80% of effort is important. Again, if you get a few basic things right, then that's great. It'll go a long way. But in most fields, you're in a competitive environment, and there's a water level competition in the industry of other people doing all the same things that you're doing too. You know, again, if you're Google, then someone else is a search algorithm that they're using. If you're a trader, then all the other investors are at least okay at their jobs, for example. And so you're kind of making progress around the margin instead. And that's where your competitive advantage comes from. That's kind of the tip of the iceberg, literally speaking. But the point here is not to say that you're going to make all this effort without relatively little gain. It's to be instead to be okay with making small wins at the margin instead. If you think about companies in this part of the country that are successful, again, you know, Google, Facebook, Uber now, and so forth, those companies are making lots and lots of minor improvements to their products every day. I'm not sure there's any kind of one big idea behind Facebook, for example, but they're always testing new things, collecting new data, and making refinement at the margin. It's a lot more credible to make a lot of 1% improvements and have those add up over time through trial and error than to make one miracle improvement that oftentimes proves to be too good to be true. So learning through trial and error and, you know, realizing that your job is never done as a data scientist, there are always ways to improve things, whether you've succeeded or failed. That's an attitude that I think will prove to provide more success in the long run. So I'll leave you now with a little poem from Piet Hein, who's a data scientist and author, who expresses what I think is the right attitude to have in the era of big data. The road to wisdom, well, it's plain and simple to express, error and error and error again, but less and less and less. So thank you very much.